Hi, this is Dr. Karthik Chandra, surgical oncologist from Vishakhapatnam. So my team is here along with me, Dr. Sajit and Dr. Uma Shankar. We will be taking the classes for the Assure NEET Super Speciality Oncosurgery Division. And this is just a model class. We are starting off with this model class on soft tissue sarcoma. My colleagues, Dr. Sajit, can you say hi? Dr. Sajit, please introduce yourself.
Hi, Dr. Sajit, I'm working in Kerala, in Kottayam at Caritas Cancer Institute. So I finished my MCH in 2017 and have been here since then. Yep.
Dr. Uma, can you introduce yourself?
I am Dr. Uma Shankar. Actually, I did my MCH in Tata Memorial. I completed in 2017. Presently, I am in Hyderabad working in Yashoda Hospital, Malakpet. So, I will be taking the classes along with the Dr. Karthik and Dr. Sajit. Yeah.
Welcome, both of you. All three of us are ex-Tata Memorial residents. So I guess we will make your job easier in cracking the NEET Super Speciality exam. Without much ado, I'll start sharing my screen and the PowerPoint presentation. This will be a model for the future classes also. And if you have any feedback also, please put it, please forward it to us so that we can modify anything if you have such suggestions. So. Hi guys, can you see my screen? Uma and Sajit? Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. So, yeah, I'll go on to the. So, just a question on risk factors for soft tissue sarcomas. So, prior radiation exposure predisposes to many soft tissue sarcomas. But one among these is not, does not occur in radiation fields. Which one is it? Liposarcoma, angiosarcoma, malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor, undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma. So just brief note on what are the radiation associated sarcomas. One of the most common ones is the unclassified pleomorphic sarcoma, which was previously called as the malignant MPH, malignant pleomorphic histiocytoma. Now it has been renamed as the UPS actually. And angiosarcoma, leiomyosarcoma, fibrosarcomas, and malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumors, all these are associated with prior radiation exposure. They might ask you some questions related to whether the radiation, whether the sarcoma onset is dose dependent or not. Yes, it is dose dependent. And usually the radiation related sarcomas occur at the periphery of the radiation pool, not at the center of the radiation pool. Okay. So radiation related soft tissue sarcomas have poorer prognosis, note that. And they, hence they have a shorter disease specific survival. Usually there is a period of around 10 years, at least it around 10 years for a sarcoma to develop in a prior radiation field. So this is about radiation induced sarcomas. So liposarcoma is the answer because angiosarcoma, MPNST, undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma are radiation associated STS. Okay, that's the first question. So this is a question regarding neurofibroma. Which is the wrong statement regarding neurofibromatosis? So NF1 gene is located in 17q11, the long arm of 17 chromosome 17. It acts as a tumor suppressor of the RAP oncogene. The commonest sarcoma in neurofibroma occurring in the background of neurofibromatosis is malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor. And then it predisposes to glioblastoma. So which do you think is the wrong statement regarding NF1? So for this question, you have to have read Sabiston very detailedly. So enough neurofibromatosis and other cancer-related syndromes are favorite questions for the examiner because it's very easy to set the question, standard questions. So neurofibroma is an autosomal dominant condition, and mutations of the occurring in the mutation of the NF1 gene chromosome occurring in 17q11.2, and it codes for a protein called neurofibromin. It's a tumor suppressor of the RAS oncogene, okay, signaling pathway, and there's a significant risk of malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor. It also predisposes to schwannomas and gliomas. So I said RAS oncogene. And the option given was RAF oncogene. So BRAF and other RAF oncogenes are different. KRAS and RAS, that is a different family. So the NF1 codes for the RAS oncogene signaling pathway. So that is the wrong statement with regards to NF neurofibromatosis. So, yeah. So just a point regarding sarcomas in general. Sarcomas are more common in extremities more than the trunk. Proximal location is more common. That is, so proximal thigh is one of the commonest sites for extremity soft tissue sarcoma. And in children, the variants are slightly different. So rhabdomyosarcoma, hemangioma, neurofibroma, and alveolar sarcoma are more common soft tissue tumors in the children. Now, nodal spread is least commonly seen in which type of soft tissue sarcoma? Please note that nodal spread is uncommon in soft tissue sarcoma. Only 5 to 10% of sarcomas have nodal spread. And so which of these usually does not have a nodal spread? Angiosarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma, or malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor. So as I said, there is a mnemonic for this. You might have read it previously also. So one mnemonic was RACES. This is cream L. So clear cell sarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, epithelioid sarcoma, angiosarcoma, malignant fibrous histiocytoma or the undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma, and liposarcoma. Liposarcoma is also still uncommon, but the other five variants are common variants where nodal involvement occurs. So the wrong option is MPNST. So it does not occur, nodal spread does not occur in MPNSTs. Okay. So, yeah. So for any cancer or any tumor, what people expect you to know is staging and prognostic factors and risk factors. So usually staging is very commonly asked in the NEET exams. So please be prepared with staging and prognostic factors. These are favorite questions to oncology examiners. So size, nodal metastasis, depth of invasion, and grade. Mind you, all these are prognostic factors, but you have to choose which is the worst as per your understanding. So for this, I'll go into the staging. The latest staging is the AJCC 8th edition staging. So you have to know that. And that is different from the previous edition, 7th edition. So if you guys have been reading the previous edition or the previous edition of Sabiston or similar book, please be careful because the staging has changed. So T1 tumors are tumors less than 5 centimeter. T2 tumors are 5 to 10 centimeters. T3 are more than 10 centimeters, 10 to 15 centimeters. And T4 are 15 centimeters. So less than 5, 5 to 10, 10 to 15, and more than 15. Any nodal met is classified as N1. Any distant met is classified as M1. So any regional node is classified as N1, mind you. And you have to also note the grading system. So there is a three-tier grading systems. And this is the French grading system called as the FNC-LCC. So So just remember the French grading system, and it takes into account the differentiation, the mitotic count, and also necrosis score. So these are the three factors which are taken into account to put it as a grade 1, 2, or 3, low grade, intermediate grade, or high grade. So grade is a very significant prognostic factor for sarcomas. So please remember this classification. And if you look at the stage grouping, so you have the stage grouping, which is stage 1, 2, 3, 4. So remember, any nodal metastasis makes it stage 4. This is the staging for the extremities of tissue sarcoma. So that's why nodal metastasis is the worst prognostic factor if there is any nodal metastasis. And also grade 3 is bad. So that's where it comes. So anything which is grade 3 and large lesion, T3, T4 lesion, more than 10 centimeters becomes grade 3. Anything with distant metastasis becomes grade 4. Anything with regional nodal metastasis becomes stage 4. So you have to remember that. Okay. So staging is important in all cancers. You have to know them by heart. So the worst prognostic factor is nodal metastasis. We go on to the next question. So these days in DNB super specialty entrances, you're getting questions based on images. So this is a tumor or lesion occurring in a edematous limb. So occurring in the background of lymphedema. So I think you can guess easily. This is an easy question. It's a lymphangiosarcoma or an angiosarcoma. Angiosarcoma commonly occurs in a previously lymphedematous limb. Okay, so lymphangiosarcoma or an angiosarcoma. Anything can be the right answer. So I'll go to the next question. So you might get questions on which is the best investigation modality. Okay, so just a few points I'll tell you before I go on to other questions. So the best modality for surgical planning, for surgical resection of a trunk or extremity soft tissue sarcoma would be the MRI scan. A contrast MRI, enhanced MRI scan would be even better. And because this gives you very good soft tissue delineation. So any place where you have to get good soft tissue delineation, MRI is the best imaging modality. And contrast helps you in differentiating or localizing it or reading about the vascular bundle and the neurovascular bundle. So MRI is the best modality. A contrast enhanced CT scan sometimes is also a good substitute, but it is important when you are thinking of if vascular resection or something is planned. But overall, the best single answer would be MRI for local staging or local surgical planning. So we usually get a chest CT scan for ruling out distant metastasis. Mind you, all intermediate and high grade sarcomas and sarcomas more than 3 to 5 centimeters in size, we need to get a distant staging done. So only probably for the low grade sarcomas less than 3 centimeters in size, we can avoid the chest CT scan. Now, for certain aggressive histological types, like the myxoid or round cell liposarcoma or the epithelioid sarcoma or the angiosarcoma and leiomyosarcoma, we would like to get a CT abdomen or pelvis because these might have a hematogenous metastasis to the liver or lymph nodal metastasis, retroperitoneal nodal metastasis. So we would put a CT abdomen or pelvis. We would also get brain imaging done, either an MRI or CT brain, whenever there are alveolar soft part sarcoma or clear cell sarcoma and angiosarcoma. Okay. So that is about imaging. This is briefly about management. So this is directly a flowchart taken from Saviston. So we need to, so the initial biopsy is very important. So biopsy is mandatory usually before starting treatment. Maybe in a 2 centimeter or 3 centimeter lesion, we might avoid a biopsy, but in all other cases, we usually require a core biopsy at least Only if you're not getting adequate tissue, we go for an incisional biopsy, but the true cut biopsy or the core biopsy is the mandatory investigation. We prefer doing a CT or the imaging, the CT or the MRI scan before doing a biopsy for better planning of the biopsy. So based on the CT, the MRI findings, the biopsy findings, we classify into low grade and high grade and size we get to know. And then whether they are a chemosensitive sarcoma or not, we get to know. And then the treatment proceeds accordingly. So a low grade sarcoma, small lesion, we would just go ahead with surgical excision and negative margins. We don't bother about any adjuvant therapy. Only if there is a microscopic positive margin, we consider post-operative radiotherapy, external beam radiotherapy. Whereas it's a high-grade sarcoma, we look if there are extremely chemosensitive tumors like Ewing sarcoma or rhabdomyosarcoma, giving preoperative chemotherapy is mandatory. But in all other cases of high-grade sarcomas, we usually go for surgical resection. So less than 5 cm, the decision is easy. We go ahead with the resection, aiming for a margin more than 2 cm. The final histopathological report, if we get at least 1 cm margin, then we are safe. And small lesions, no adjuvant therapy. 5 to 10 centimeter lesions, that's T2 lesions. We consider perioperative brachytherapy or postoperative external beam radiotherapy. And more than 10 centimeters, brachytherapy is not an option. We have to go for external beam radiotherapy. And among external beam radiotherapy, intensity modulated radiotherapy is preferred. So if the margins are not very good, if it is less than 1 centimeter margin or microscopic postoperative positive margin, for less than 5 centimeter tumor also, we might have to consider postoperative external beam radiotherapy. So for anything more than that, definitely we have to go for adjuvant radiation. So if there is any unplanned resection, so somebody who is not specialized in oncosurgery, or a surgeon does an excision biopsy of the tumor, then we definitely have to go for re-excision and get good margins. Okay. So any of points in this flowchart may be asked you in the exam. So I have not put it as an MCQ. Okay. So please study this flowchart in detail. Okay. So lipomas are very heterogeneous tumors. So you might have some very well-differentiated liposarcoma, also called as atypical lipomatous tumors. And you have the poor prognostic variants, that is the myxoid or round cell variants. So when do you suspect liposarcomatous transformation in a lipoma? So this whenever. These are all the points which you have to keep in mind. So whenever the tumor size is larger than 10 centimeter, whenever there are thick septae, whenever there are non-adipose areas or fibromatous areas or solid areas in multiple solid areas in the lipoma, and when the lesions are having less than 75% adipose tissue, we need to suspect liposarcomatous transformation. So this can be asked as an MCQ. So liposarcomas are the most commonest retroperitoneal sarcomas. And there are these are the commonest histological variants, well-differentiated and de-differentiated, or pleomorphic liposarcomas, myxoid and round cell liposarcomas. These are listed in the order of decreasing frequency, but increasing aggressiveness. So desmoid tumors are another favorite question for examiners. So desmoid tumors identify the wrong statement. So most are sporadic tumors. Local recurrences are common. Distant metastases are rare and occur due to the unstabilization of the beta-catenin protein. So we need to identify the wrong statement. So remember, 75 to 85% of desmoid tumors are sporadic. Around 20% are related to the FAP syndrome, familial adenomatosis polyposis coli syndrome. These are more common in women. occur more commonly after pregnancy are associated with antecedent trauma, and defects in the WNT, WNT signaling pathway cause desmoid tumors. And in sporadic cases, the CTNNB1 mutation occurs. In FAP-related cases, the APC gene gets mutated. So the beta-catenin protein is stabilized because of these mutations, either the CTNNB1 mutation or the APC gene mutation. And the beta-catenin protein gets accumulated in the cell, and this leads to desmoid tumors. So the option I gave was beta-catenin unstabilization. So that is the wrong statement. Desmoid tumors occur due to the stabilization of the beta-catenin protein and accumulation in the cell. So option 4 is the wrong statement. Okay. So angiosarcomas are more commonly radiation associated, and they occur commonly in the trunk. Breast is a common location for trunk angiosarcomas, especially these are radiation associated. Head and neck also common sites, and especially they occur commonly in the scalp. Now, please note, these occur more commonly above 60 years of age, and they have a very high chance of lung mets, and we commonly prefer to do a PET scan whenever we detect an angiosarcoma. At least a CT chest is mandatory. And what are the specific IHC markers for angiosarcoma? CD31 and FLI1 or FLI1. CD31 is a particular marker for blood vessels, for the endothelium of the vessels. So, because angiosarcomas are tumors of the blood vessels occurring from the endothelium, so CD31 is an important IHC marker. These are usually chemosensitive and also very aggressive cancers. So, just a brief differentiation. Whenever you're tackling soft tissue tumors in the OPD or for the exam purposes at least, you need to know which are the tumors with the low metastatic potential and which are the tumors with the high metastatic potential. So desmoid tumors and the atypical lipomatous tumors or the well-differentiated liposarcoma, dermatofibrosarcoma protuberans, hemangiopericytoma, these are very low metastatic potential. Though these are aggressively in terms of recurrences locally, distant metastatic potential is low for both desmoid tumors and DFSP. Whereas the metastatic potential is high for the undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma, liposarcoma, the dedifferentiated and pleomorphic sarcomas, and angiosarcoma, leiomyosarcoma, clear cell, epithelioid, the extraskeletal leavings, synovial sarcoma, etc. And some of the variants like myxoid liposarcoma, myxofibrosarcoma, extraskeletal chondrosarcoma have intermediate metastatic potential. So, yeah, this is in brief about soft tissue sarcomas. I'll stop my class here. So this will be the rough paradigm for the presentations that we have. So in addition to these kind of PowerPoint presentations, we'll also have mock exams. We'll also have, we'll also be circulating PDFs with important information about the most important cancers or cancer-related questions. We'll also be having a Telegram group where we'll have we'll be passing on snippets and some MCQs. So please do join the Assure Medical Foundation and join the Assure Neat Super Speciality.